when we got it up. That didn't sound right. Wow, I'm so blushing right now.
Yes.
I meant, oh, there it is. I'm so happy. It's so nice to see so many of you here who I know, especially those of us who went to school together in the 80s. And some of the younger set, it's really great. It's really nice to talk about my community, to talk about gay, lesbian, bi, trans, queer, two-spirited people, and health. And to present some ideas around how we might look after or look out for gay, lesbian, bi, trans, queer, two-spirited people. So this we've called this presentation Coming In, or Community Safety, what communities can do to support lesbian, gay, bi, trans, queer, two-spirit positions and Aboriginal peoples. So just as far as some background, the First Nations Health Authority, and I think all of us who are in the Indigenous community understand that a holistic approach is optimal, that thinking of our health and well-being as being more positive-based instead of deficit-based, that we think about health and wellness, not just the health system, and that we're concerned about the wellness of our mind, body, and spirit, not just the wellness of our bodies. This is something that we're committed to at the First Nations Health Authority, and I hope it's something that you're committed to, and that I think many, many, many of us try and keep our balance in our health and well-being. We try and be well in our bodies, and in our minds, and in our spirits, and in our everyday, including things like our relationships. So, talking about two-spirit people, the idea of two-spirit people is one that I think is quite old, and one that's kind of modern as well, in that there have always been two-spirit people. We know that by looking back at many of the records from ancient civilizations. So two-spirit people, or gay, lesbian, bi, trans, queer people, have always been a part of every society. But whether they are open or not visible depends on the culture. And I think our cultures were very, very permissive. Certainly where I come from, the attitude towards two-spirit people, a traditional viewpoint still exists, and we're very, very accepting. I think maybe in the modern, that has been less so. Maybe in some of the kind of more modern, sexophobic, binary-driven societies, maybe we're not perceived in such a positive light. But for us, we've always been seen as very much a part of the family. And in fact, not just a part of the family, but a valuable part of the family. And not just a valuable part of the family, but we have special roles that have often been ours. We've been teachers and knowledge keepers. We've been healers. We've been herbalists and spiritual leaders. Interpreters, mediators, and of course, very often artists. This doesn't include also being, uncles. Some of us are even parents, some of us are aunties and grandparents. And some of us are very loving brothers and sisters and play significant roles in our biological families, not just in society at large. So with colonization affected all of us. So colonization affected indigenous two-spirited people as well. And very much like indigenous women, our role as two-spirited people was greatly devalued, I think. And we suffered the same losses as other indigenous people, loss of our culture, loss of knowledge. But we're moving back to respect and acceptance. Or maybe for many of us, we just didn't ever lose it. I think what we arrive at today, though, is that very often we're not part of policy frameworks. We're not necessarily a part of the policy structure. And we'd like to change that. So, for instance, the First Nations Health Authority, we plan for the health of First Nations people, but we don't necessarily plan for two-spirit health. And that should change. So, what does that look like? Well, two-spirit people are not exempt from social determinants of health, and that if you ask two-spirit people what makes you well, sometimes they'll answer the same thing as other indigenous people, things like love, relationships, family, culture. But then there are also some other ideas that are important to us, things like equality, or sometimes called equity, ideas of fairness and safety, that we live in a fair society where we have equal opportunity to other people, or straight people, or straight allies, and that we be allowed to have our own culture. Because I think for some of us as gay, lesbian, bi, trans, queer, two-spirit people, we have a very unique culture that should be allowed to exist. We shouldn't have to trade our two-spirit culture in order to exist with our straight allies or to be within our families. So what does our particular culture and our wellness look like? Oh, and here are some of the other determinants of health. I do like to ask people what personally makes them well, recognizing that many of you already understand that social determinants of health play a part of that, meaning that there are other things besides the obvious that keep us well. So it's very well proven, for instance, that if you are wealthier, generally you're healthier, and that if you're poorer, generally you suffer more and die younger. And so there's a very tight correlation between the social determinants of health, the social determinants of health and our wellness. Just to give you an example, I was part of a study that watched gay men as they seroconverted, as they got HIV. They took several thousand of us and watched us as young gay men to see which of us would get HIV. And then they looked back at the histories and the demographics, what these young men's lives were like to see who would get HIV. And what they found was that young men who were underemployed, young men who were poor, young men who had a lower level of education, who had poor housing, got HIV at a faster rate than men who were more highly educated, wealthier, with better housing, et cetera, et cetera. And it corroborated once again that the more resources you have, the better you do. So here are some other ideas. Access to a healthcare center, access to a drop-in center where presumably you would have access to support. Sexual healthcare, we are defined a bit by our sexual identity, so our sexual behavior does somewhat define our health and well-being. Access to counseling and other programs. Ideas like political will. I worked once with a minister of health we were looking at trans care, and he said, really, we're in charge of this, kind of in a snarky way, that, you know, oh, we look after trans surgeries, we look after trans people. And what I wanted to say to him was, yes, sir, we look after all British Columbians, not just the ones we like. We look after everyone. And so, yes, we have a responsibility to trans people and their health and well-being. And that wasn't always the case. It's actually fairly modern that we're more supportive of trans people. So political will is a determinant of health. And just as an aside, research does show that two-spirit people are often marginalized. They live at the margins of society. And many more of us are poor than the general population. And this, of course, is a risk for poor health. So the work that we do then to support gay, lesbian, bi, trans, two-spirit, queer, two-spirit health revolve around as well the social determinants of health. So access to care is a determinant of health in that you should have access to primary care, which is a first point of contact to your health and well-being. A first point of contact can be a counselor, it can be a clinic in your community, it can be a family doctor, it can be a nurse or a street nurse, or maybe it's someone else, certainly in our on our reserves, in our territories. Sometimes that worker is a paraprofessional who gives us a first point of contact. And some would even say that primary care are all the things that you need for the basics of your health and well-being. So it may include things like a food system or a safe place to sleep. care. So barriers of care can be the feeling of discrimination within the healthcare services. So I know this is generally a barrier to Indigenous people. We can be mistrustful of institutions because maybe we had history there, like we had a history of neglect from that institution. Maybe we historically we had an experience in that health system that wasn't very positive, and we feel like if we go back there, we'll have a debasing, degrading, hopeless and experience instead of getting help. You know, the experience or experience with the healthcare system should be helpful, and if it's not helpful, then it's failing you. And we may distrust the entirety of the system, or we may distrust the staff, or we may distrust the philosophy of that institution, and that becomes a barrier for us receiving care. And if you've ever heard me speak before, I've spoken very often that Aboriginal people with HIV 10 years ago were dying at a very, very fast rate compared to non-Aboriginal people with HIV. In part because there seemed to be these barriers that we needed to identify that were stopping us from getting medications and stopping us from receiving care at many of the excellent HIV care centers. And those barriers weren't just things like homophobia or geographic isolation. They were probably related to some other factors, including, did we feel comfortable and safe at those places of care? For many of us, as two-spirited people, rural versus urban is an idea we need to figure out. Does living in the bush, does living on reserve, does living in a remote area protect our health, or does it risk our health because we don't have access to tertiary care centers? Or does living in the city protect our health because we're near healthcare systems and other people who are like us? Or is living in the city a risk because there are so many negative aspects of living in the center? And the jury is still out. We're still trying to figure that out. And probably it's a complicated answer in that for many of us, the city or the country is a risk or a supportive positive factor, and it's idiosyncratic, it's personal to us. Of course, ideally, what we would like to have is that for you as Indigenous two-spirit people, you would receive care in the city and in the country in the bush. For many of us, we are forced to relocate from the place that we want to be. We have to leave the city because it's too expensive and go home. Or we may have to leave home because we need employment or economic opportunities or maybe we need care and we're forced to the city. Ideally, in a kinder universe, we would have a choice. And I think what we all inherently understand is that we flow back and forth. Sometimes we're at home, sometimes we're away from home. Sometimes we can make a living in the city, sometimes we can make a living at home. Sometimes we want to be at home because we have family and culture there. But sometimes we want to be in the city because of the things that it offers us. So no matter where we are, we should have a healthcare system. And I would like to introduce the idea that some of us are more vulnerable than others. Certainly we know from the general population that younger people and older people are especially vulnerable, and that those of us who are in the middle, like you 25-year-olds to 55-year-olds, your health is generally excellent, generally you're strong, generally those are the most productive years of your life, and we don't have to worry about you. But when you're really young and when you're a little bit older, you're at risk. So for two-spirit youth, we do know that there are many forms of discrimination that they face, and we know that they absolutely deserve our support, and they absolutely deserve services, especially since half of our population is under the age of 25. So if we're not looking to protecting the wellness of those under 25, we're also missing the point. And when we hear from young people, they talk about having a safe place. Safety is important to young people. They want to be free from bullying. They want to be free from discrimination, and they want to have places that are theirs. They want youth-only spaces or spaces for young people where they can thrive instead of being subjected to the wings of older people. This also might include, because I know when I came out in the city as a teenager, we didn't really talk about sexual exploitation very much at all. That we should be looking to our elders, to older people, they shouldn't be interested in us just because we're young and sexy. They should be interested in us because we're their younger family. And so there's this idea then that older people should be safe with us. And I kind of welcome discussion on that, because I think we're starting to become more demanding in talking about sexual abuse and sexual exploitation much more easily. We're getting to be more sophisticated in that regard. So I don't want to brush it under the carpet and not talk about it. On the other hand, I also don't want to tarnish us with that stigma, because so many of us think of two-spirit people as being perverts. It's a stigma that we carry, and it's probably unfounded. Most of the sex crimes against young people are not committed by two-spirit people. So there is a resurgence, I think, of two-spirit roles. Our status in society is elevating, and this is very helpful to our health and well-being. Resiliency I'm trying to remember the definition of resilience, but it has to do with the adaptation in the face of adversity that someone pushing against you or creating pressures against you doesn't have to be negative. It can actually make you stronger. And so ideally, when we have stresses against us, like having to get an education, having to move to a city, having to find housing, having to be proud and strong, creates an environment where we thrive as opposed to it oppressing us. And many two-spirited people who are marginalized can come together for affirmation, for empowerment, for safety, and for teachings. So I want to remind us that our services are also about that, not just getting, say, blood pressure or screening or that kind of thing. Here are some two-spirit people of note to remind us of our place. Pride. Resiliency also has to do with resistance. So we resist. One concept is that we push back. When someone is negative to us, we stand up for ourselves, that this is a very positive coping mechanism, not a negative one. In fact, I think it's very traditional. Certainly when I was growing up, I was taught to be strong. If someone tries to steal from you, to hurt you, or hurt your family, you don't just take it. You say, no, this is wrong. I have a firm set of beliefs, and I can stick up for myself and protect myself when I need to. Artists can galvanize us and inspire us and be role models to us and remind us of the heights that we can aspire to. We don't have to accept a lower position in society or accept whatever some people feel like handing to us. This is Tyler Allen Jacobs, a young two-spirit person locally who people talk to about being a role model, and he has some ideas. And I think probably some of you here have carried the title of being a role model. And I know that that can be a burden, but it also can be very positive and can point the way, point in a meaningful direction to those who are coming after us or who are younger than us. So, the process of reclaiming ourselves, our identity, and our position in society, and our self-acceptance, of who we are and our lot in life, has been described as coming in rather than coming out. The old idea of coming out is being visible or identifiable to yourself, to your family, and to others, like your friends or in the workplace. But coming in describes a personal self-acceptance, a personal excellence, and a personal affirmation of one's identity, where one fits, who one is, rather than trying to conform to the society around us. So these kinds of spiritual and emotional aspirations are part of a wellness system that we are looking to build. So, building a two-spirit community then talks about reclamation and resilience. That can mean including accepting and claiming traditional roles, traditional cultural roles, and traditional and cultural responsibilities. So when I came out, my dad was really a tough soccer playing guy, an ex-boxer, but he didn't care that I was two-spirited. But he said, you know, I hope you'll be a dad, because, you know, we value the role of parenthood. Stupidly, I said, okay, I'll do that. Not realizing how much work that is as a gay man to make a baby. But he wanted that traditional role for me, and I accepted it. We want to achieve a positive self-identity. We want to be proud of ourselves, proud of our lives, proud of our choices, proud of our partnerships. I remember trying to explain to my family that I didn't want my family to be embarrassed about my boyfriend partner and think of my boyfriend partner as being second class to my sister's husbands, that was unfair. And it took them a while to understand that. No one had ever challenged them in that regard, that my husband was equal to their husbands, but I did. That we have a supportive community who speaks up for us and protects us. We mentor young two-spirited people, and we're positive to them. And that we look to healthy communities rather than unhealthy communities. Another part of reclaiming two-spirit roles and identities is to better equip LGBTQ2 community health programs and initiatives. And here are some examples. Developing forms that allow clients to self-identify. Training staff to use gender-neutral language. Providing gender-neutral washrooms. And providing appropriate environments which reflect both the indigeneity and the diversity of sexual and gender identities through art. So our workplace at the First Nations Health Authority tries to be egalitarian and equal in all of these regards. It's not a big ask for your workplace to do exactly this. Because there are so many barriers to two-spirit people claiming their health, engaging in social services, and being present in their communities, we do need to create those safe environments as much as we can. And research has shown that health initiatives which reflect the identities of two-spirit people can have a positive impact on their health through their engaging with us in a better way. So, in order to better account for the lives of two-spirit people, Aboriginal health research policy and programming must begin to challenge binary gender frameworks and heteronormative models of sexuality which push two-spirit people out of view. For example, when we were doing some recent two-spirit planning and we were looking at women's health and men's health, very often we think of the obvious, things like sexually transmitted infections and HIV, and the two-spirit men that we spoke to said, we've been talking and learning about HIV for, since we were teenagers. You know, can we get to other issues that are important to us, like our mental health, or even, more complex ideas like parenthood or the health of our parents? Because we're concerned about those as well. And so our planning needs to incorporate those kinds of concepts that are on our minds as two-spirit people. Cultural safety is to create an environment free of racism and discrimination where people feel safe receiving care. I remember one of the first times I went to hospital, I think I cut my finger and I needed some stitches. The clerk who was admitting me, she was asking me my name and my address and that kind of thing. And just out of the blue, she said, "Oh, you're an Indian." I said, "Yeah." She said, "Oh, you guys get everything for free, right?" And I thought, what is she talking about? Like, is she on crystal meth? What is this? but it was such an aggressive kind of casual racism. I would call that a microaggression, where, you know, she's, that was really outside of the purview of her work to comment on like that. So I made a joke to her. I said, yeah, in fact, there was a guy just giving away houses, so I just took five. And she looked like I was kind of crazy, and I looked at her like she was kind of crazy. And we had a bit of a standoff. So cultural safety is that we have environments where we are safe, where the health workers are not microaggressive to us, they're not racist to us, and they give us the best possible care and inclusive. So cultural safety goes beyond cultural awareness. Cultural awareness is simply the awareness of differences between cultures, which I think is not a difficult concept. We can have different realities in how we grew up. Cultural sensitivity is about realizing the legitimacy of the difference in power of one's own life experience can have on others. But the idea of cultural safety is that power imbalances inherent, the recognition that power imbalances are inherent in the healthcare system and their address, that the healthcare worker is able to reflect on the difference between their culture and that of the patient or the client, and that there can be a difference in power between them as the healthcare worker and the client, and that power, like the ability to say whatever comes to the front of your mind, maybe isn't something that should be asserted. And that we should improve our client experiences and lead to better care. Basically, that when you interact with the system, it's respectful, and it's open, and it's helpful every single time. It's quite a big ask. So at the FNHA, our vision for cultural safety and humility, we envision a future where First Nations people have a new relationship with their caregivers based on mutual respect, understanding, and reciprocal accountability, so we can ask caregivers about the work that we've done. One that provides an understanding of what health and wellness means to First Nations people that are seeking care and that we are responsible to provide. One that resets the balance of power between the care provider and the client where they're served. And one that provides for a health system that has mechanisms that proactively and effectively addresses appropriate actions and behaviors within the operations of the various health institutions. So, my organization receives complaints from lots of indigenous people about the healthcare system. Something as simple like, I think that nurse was rude to me, to this entire medical team mismanaged my loved one and they died, and everything in between. And we should be able to receive those complaints and ask questions on your behalf and say, very simply, an investigation with a small eye, where we say, what happened to lodging formal complaints with various institutions. And there are many places where we as an organization, along with your consent, will file complaints and ask for improvements. Well, not just ask, demand. I'm thinking of a case where there were lesbian moms on a maternity ward, one of them had just given birth. The non-biological mother came in with their other child, and the nurse asked them to leave. The nurse said, you can't stay here. It's just not done. And so they were asked to leave, and we received a complaint, and we arranged for an apology and for ceremony to come to that, to spirit the family. It was outside the purview of that nurse. It wasn't within the nurse's power to remove non-biological woman, or non-biological female parent and a child from the ward. So that institution issued an apology. So there is a provincial Health Trans Care BC strategic framework and a provincial Health Trans Care BC project. Mara, did you talk about this already? You haven't talked about it. So the province has recognized that it has an important role to play. Mara's pointing, and I don't understand her Maori sign language. She's pointing to the wall. And I'm trying to read
that. Hi, Evan, it's Lorraine.
Oh, there you are! Great. And have you spoken about trans here?
No.
Great. But you are here, and so we can speak to you about this. Basically, the province has acknowledged that it has a role to play in trans care, that it should be planning, that it should be safe, and we should ask, demand, encourage our healthcare workers across the health authorities to help in the care of trans people. So the Trans Care BC Vision is a British Columbia where people of all genders are able to access gender-affirming healthcare and live, work, and thrive in their communities. That if we're not providing safe care for trans people, we hurt trans people, we deny them the basic human right of healthcare, and we would be in the wrong. So we're trying to embrace a better way of operating. So here are the three strategic goals. One in peer and community supports, the second in primary care, or the first point of contact with the healthcare system, and number three is around surgery and medical support. And we're very eager to speak to communities, to trans people, and in this situation, to speak to Aboriginal and Indigenous people about trans care that works for them. So we would like very much to speak to you, and if you would like to go on the record, then do let us know. Here are the principles to guide the work from BC Trans Care Primary Care Working Group. My slide is off. There we go. So here are the goals for this work: to redesign the existing system of care, to embed trans care within a primary care model that supports clients' gender-affirming goals, is based on informed consent and provides continuity of care for clients and their families, to broaden access to culturally safer primary care for trans individuals and families across the province, to define levels of culturally safer care and identify competencies, tools, and practical requirements associated with each level for healthcare workers, and to propose process changes to streamline the care planning process for medical and surgical transition. There are the principles that we work. And I really very much believe in principles in a work environment. So when you're faced with a difficult situation that you've never thought of, something weird like the Zika virus, you can go back to the principles and the principles can point you in a solid direction. So I always think seeing the principles of some intended work really shows kind of the heart and the ethos of that work if it doesn't explicitly state what the actions or relationships are. So, accountability and transparency. So we should be able to speak clearly about the work that's being done. Person-centered care, gender-affirming care, equitable, accessible, anti-oppressive and trauma-informed, collaborative, timely, comprehensive, harm reduction, evidence-based, informed consent, culturally safer, and strength-based. Hopefully that resonates for you. So some community support in the Vancouver area, the Health Initiative for Men, the Gay Warriors Two-Spirit Talking Circle, and the Two-Spirit Sweat. Have any of you been on this? Good, some of you? I'd like to go to this sweat. You do? Great. I would love to hear more about that. You have questions for me? Okay, go for us. Great. The Vancouver Urban Native Youth Association. This is my notes on the Vancouver Urban Native Youth Association. It's terrible when you do a PowerPoint and you're not the spokesperson for that organization. You just really want to do them justice. So I excuse me while I look to my notes. So Vancouver Urban Native Youth Association, or ANYA, is Vancouver's only Native Youth Program providing organization, and they work to empower Native youth through 21 programs, which include education and training, personal support, living programs, sports and recreation, and I think the Transgender Health Information Program. All trans individuals across BC are able to access gender-affirming healthcare and engage in society feeling safe, included, and well-represented, and there's a trans youth drop-in, and a family transgender health information program for drop-in as well. Just a little plug for a really wonderful film, which I think kind of embodies some of the issues for trans people, and the story of Fred Martinez and the film called Just Friends. And that's all I just want to end. When I came out to my family, I told my dad that being out wasn't just me being out and me being out to him. It was that his friends were going to hear that I was gay. And how did you feel about that? What could we do? Because I felt bad that I was putting him in that position. And he said, oh, don't worry, no one's going to talk about you in front of me. And so that was his promise to me, that he wasn't tolerating me being bad enough, and that he didn't care what his friends thought, that he was loyal to me. And I think that story is very indigenous, because I think we ask our family members to be loyal to us and accepting of us. And I think that in indigenous health, we like to think of each other as family, that you're my cousins, and that I should treat you as such, and that under my watch, you should not be bullied and harassed, defamed and oppressed. And I hope you feel that same way towards me and towards each other, that we stick up for each other, no one's going to hurt us while we're standing all together.